Welcome, everyone. My name is Jens Hoffmann. I'm the director of exhibitions here at the Jewish Museum. And I would like to welcome you to How is Jack Goldstein? This is the third public program in a series of events that we have scheduled around the exhibition Jack Goldstein times 10,000. The final event will take place in September. On September 22nd will be a day-long symposium that will include a lot of artists that came from that are connected to Jack Goldstein from his time in New York and Los Angeles, and also younger artists that have been influenced by Goldstein and members of the so-called Pictures generation. So tonight I have the pleasure of introducing John Baldessari and R.H. Quaytman. Rebecca Quaytman. And the idea of our conversation tonight was to, idea behind the conversation tonight was to bring together someone who has been very influential on Jack Goldstein, which is John, who was one of his teachers, or very influential in the development of Jack's art. And I think Jack was also working with you as a teaching assistant at CalArts.
Teaching assistant, yeah.
Yeah. And while I guess Rebecca is not necessarily directly influenced by Jack's work, it's probably fair to say that the generation of artists or the group of artists coming out of that generation has been very influential to your work, obviously.
I have a lot of thoughts about his work, but it wasn't like in terms of maybe influence, but more in terms of actually now more.
Yeah. Well, what I thought was interesting in terms of, and maybe this is really sort of the beginning of our conversation, was how Goldstein in some way was sort of like trying to insert a different style, different aesthetic, a different way of thinking around minimalism in his work. And what you were saying to me before earlier was also like the way that you're dealing with painting and conceptualism, almost like, you know, rehashing, looking back to a particular movement that came before you.
Right.
And I think in your case, it's a little the same as well. When I think about the cremation project of, you know, you burning down all your paintings and then moving on to something completely different, or, you know, really try to making an end and a beginning to something else.
Go ahead.
Well, I think we both, like all three of us, sort of the big drama was try to figure out how to get other kinds of ideas into, well, I can't speak for you, but for me, and I think Jack Goldstein, to get other kinds of ideas into a two-dimensional, in my case, painting practice, and also for a long time his. And that was the history of trying to put other ideas into painting is pretty fascinating, I think. And so,
well, I think with Jack, for me, the interesting thing in the course of his development, the first work that he was doing was minimal work, and very elegant, very beautifully finished, which is part of the LA aesthetic at that time. Sort of elegant versions, let's say, of Carl Andre or Robert Morris, Don Judd.
And for all of you who have been downstairs in the exhibition, when you enter on the left side next to the wall, there's an early work by Jack that was, it's a remake of a work that he made and then destroyed, apparently, after following your advice.
Anyway. Moving right along now. I think Jack, had a huge ego like any good artist. And he was the CalArts grew out of an earlier art school called Chouinard Art Institute that was largely funded by Disney. And when CalArts started, I think we only took two faculty members from Chouinard, pretty brutal, but, starting afresh, I guess. and we only took two of their students. Only one of their students. We had selected two. The first one said no, he had a career already going, and the second was Jack. He started out being the only sort of holdover student from the two schools in a completely different environment. You know, at Chouinard, it was pretty much the abstract expressionist mode, just paint away and, just paint. That was pretty much it. they weren't too verbal there. So Jack, was a good student coming from a good art school. But when CalArts started, we didn't accept that many people. We had a lot of people applying. So in effect, what happened, the students that did come, they were all art stars where they had come from. But then all of a sudden, you have 50 art stars all together. That's a lot of ego collision. And I actually had this theory, which I think was pretty much true, that the students taught each other by this competing. They had to clatter the way to the top again.
Yeah.
So there was that. So I think I would have talked to Jack more if he had talked more. matter of fact, I sometimes call myself the art doctor, that I wasn't a teacher at all, that students came to me and said, my art is sick and make it well. But Jack never did that.
Well, that's because the strength was its illness in a way.
What?
I mean, in a way, the strength is it's mortally wounded in a funny way.
Well,
I mean,
can talk to that later about, it's a myth about an artist that they should be wounded and damaged. At any rate, I thought we all nice work, but you're all doing nice work. And I think what Jack got from me was finding a way to do art that didn't involve the kind of art he was doing. I think in that level we connected.
And some of these earlier works are probably the early performance films that we've seen. I remember reading about a work where he buried himself in the parking lot of CalArts.
Yes, it took place outside of CalArts, which was... Even then, they were not rural, but there were a lot of rolling hills. I mean, there wasn't a lot of building going on around it. And it was just as, it was getting dark at dusk. And you got there, and there was just this mound of dirt. On top of it was this blinking red light, which was cooked up, to his heart. You could see his heart pulsing. And I was absolutely blown away. I thought, wow, this is quite amazing. And just that the risk he was taking, and I do think that's what art's about. I think it's the best thing he's ever done.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, it sort of reminded me a lot of other work that was perhaps going on in Los Angeles at that time, and obviously very reminded of Chris Burden, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Chris Burden. In terms
but... Yeah, Chris might have buried himself. It's possible. I haven't seen him do it.
One of the things that I think connects the three of you are the work is, on the one hand, a fascination with language, and words, poetry as well, and of course the image and questions around the image and the questions around representation, where I think... a lot of the artists in the picture generation had almost an aggressive response to the overload of images that they were confronted with growing up in post-war America. In your work, Rebecca, the images come from somewhere else.
I'm really more European in that sense, and I never really connected in the 80s with the focus on pop culture so much. I didn't feel... the profound threat of it, I guess, because I grew up in Soho, or I don't know, it just wasn't, it didn't seem so terrible, or I just wasn't interested in that much. So in that way, I'm really different from the California artist, but reading over a lot of this material, it occurs to me that a dialogue between Germany and, I'd say, L.A. grew out of those years, and your group and influence that I think really did influence me a lot. But it wasn't so much American pop culture, but nevertheless, I am interested in melodrama and the problem of simply the draw of a picture, period, whatever picture it is. Like how to get out of that, just that suction.
And when you say about the relationship between the West Coast and Germany, do you mean
LA and Germany.
LA and Germany.
Like LA, Cologne.
LA, Cologne. But this is a different generation than the generation of Jack.
I guess, but
there was no connection in the 70s between Germany and LA, you know. And I don't know that there ever was, but if you
maybe
say so.
No, I think maybe there was. But I mean, I think I was wondering whether you mean something like galleries like Conrad Fischer that brought artists over to Germany, or Schottler.
Yeah, and then just
But that was one way. At that time,
it was one way. It didn't get.
I think there's two artists that could get shows in Soho: Joseph Beuys and Ulrich Ruckriem. Germany loved Americans, but it didn't work the other way. And we had none of that. That was New York. It was in L.A.
I read in an article recently that Walter Benjamin was saying in the 1930s that the illiteracy of the future will not be our inability to read, but to understand pictures. And I wonder what you make of that remark.
Me,
both of you.
Well, sure. I think my interest in imagery came less out of painting, but having for a while, in high school, a parallel interest in photography, and I had a dark room and everything, and then I couldn't figure out why. At that time, photography had its own history, and art had its own history, and I didn't. Mm-hmm. I said, "Well, it's all about imagery. Well, what's the problem?" So once I had given up painting and got into photography, I just start collecting images, and mm-hmm. I sat on the other night on a seminar event talking about Art Swagger in L.A. And I said, I read with scissors. When I read in the morning, LA Times, I just clip things out. Any imagery that I do a double take on, I said, well, I did a double take on that for some reason. I don't know why, but I'll find out maybe eventually. So, and I think I passed that on a lot, to students I worked with, just. Mostly banal imagery. I think that was what I was pushing. That it was interesting because it was banal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, I think his images, weirdly, were also banal, but also melodramatic, and there was a kind of like there was a fear and danger and. But they're banal at the same time. That I'm interested in about how he accomplished that in a way.
Yeah, it's a fascination also with something kind of dark
when
you
very
think
dark,
about the early
dark.
Paintings and the bombings and then. Later, the sort of natural phenomenons. They're also sort of threatening, but at the same time, they all also have a beautiful quality to them, as much as they are also horrifying.
Well, like he uses Leni Riefenstahl's photograph in one of the images, and
Margaret Brooke White is the one that's The I think that the jump is a Leni Riefenstahl connection, yeah. Mm-hmm. Where he uses for the piece the springboard mm-hmm. jumpers from Olympia.
Yeah, and his buddy Trey Brontek was into that kind of imagery, you know, of Nazi Germany as well, mm-hmm. All very black.
Well, I guess, I mean, his father was Jewish, his mother was, he was born in Canada, his mother was British, they met in World War II. I don't know if he was in the Air Force, I kind of wonder about that.
His dad.
Yeah, but the dad, it seemed, continued in the military, which is sort of surprising. I just think that's sort of interesting. So there was that trauma there, obviously, of World War II, sublimated maybe.
Yeah, I'm really worried at those kinds of readings.
You
know. I do the same. I catch myself doing the same thing, and I just hate myself. You know, because I'm first generation American. You know that. You know, I was encouraged to make money, forget about art. I never got any praise from my father. And it sounds good. You know, and no artist is going to say, you know, I just had a really boring life. I mean, nobody wants to hear about that.
You mean you're against sort of dramatizing his life in terms of interpreting his work?
Jack was buying into the idea of the suffering artist.
You think?
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's a form of self-mystification.
Because I get the impression when I read his writing that he was really against the cult of the artist. Like, he was...
Yeah, that's an interesting paradox.
He would say he was against that.
Well, yeah.
So you think that was just not true?
Well, you're not going to say, you know, come on, you have to go against that stuff like that. You have to, you have to negate it.
I guess. But, I mean, the whole sort of evacuation of the self in painting isn't an easy thing, or wasn't an easy thing to accomplish, still isn't. I mean, and I think he was insanely a genius at that in a very scary way, actually. Not in his life, but in his work. I do think that's really interesting about his work. And do you know?
What exactly?
That there is no self in his work.
There's no self.
A really, really radically no self. That I think is a kind of, was the goal that is so fierce and so violent in a way that I think it's interesting now. I wouldn't really have wanted to know him or anything, but he seems maybe.
Well, on the other hand, you know, with those paintings, he said, "I want to make paintings that will blow off the wall," and be so and say, "You know, that's Jack Goldstein."
Yeah, but he was also.
How does he accomplish that removal of him,
like,
of the self, of the of him? How does he accomplish that in the work, in your opinion?
In my opinion.
Or how do you accomplish that in general? Because I feel like by every choice you make, you're still inserting your subjectivity.
Well, he said that he wanted to make images that went into your memory like an aphorism. And an aphorism is very simple, memorable sentence or two short statement that is a kind of definition, one side of which is fact and the other is mystery. And I think that his work accesses this kind of dislocation from the possibility of even at all being a self, period. Like, he is buried. Like, his first piece is all his pieces. The burial in the driveway is every piece, I think. I mean, I like to think about art that way. It's just more dramatic.
Yeah.
Maybe. Sure. I just, then I do think I get that from it.
Well, you have two different viewpoints.
Mm-hmm. No, I don't necessarily, yeah.
That's good.
It doesn't make any sense to think about your work in those terms. So perhaps that's also why you step away from that. You know, I would never say, oh, this is because your father never gave you any praise. It's just not something that comes to mind when I look at your work.
No.
Yeah, and I think, you know, that, you know, it's a, what's the term anyway, to think about work as being autobiographical, you know, I mean, I love a lot of art, and I think the artists are just dopes, and vice versa. And I mean, I see a lot of stupid art by smart people. You know, I mean, there's no connection.
Yeah.
Follow up on that now, just.
So we have two type of audiences that come to the gallery. And one type of audience says, or in response, says, oh, I didn't know about all these paintings. Most of the work I was familiar with were the films or the records or the sounds. And then mm-hmm. we have another group of audiences who come and say, we have never seen these films, or we didn't know about the sound pieces or the records. I thought it was interesting that there is... this two different ways of looking at his work.
Sounds like the sheep and the goats to me.
Why do you think that is?
But I think all the work is
there
the
really
same.
Such a radical difference between the early work and the later work? I mean, I don't see that. For me, it's extremely consistent when I go and look at the exhibition or go and look at work.
What Jack was a little late in getting was of those artists that from CalArts that went to New York, who were able to describe, you know, to transcribe a lot of the, you know, ideas around, you know, going around CalArts, but putting them into painting. And that's the message they got right away. You know, we better do paintings. Mm-hmm. And Jack was a little late to get on to that. That's.
But. You know, you have a very sort of straightforward idea about it, where you would say that Jack got into painting because he wanted to make money, because he wanted.
Yeah,
to,
yeah. That's true.
But I would counter that with saying I have no interest in Jack Goldstein. It's the work that's saying that.
Yeah, but that's you. You're not Jack Goldstein.
But you're saying I'm saying it's about him. Huh? Your disagreement with me is what I'm saying is that I'm saying. I'm interpreting his work autobiographically, but I'm not actually. I'm saying the work is this radical message of non-subjectivity. Okay. I think.
Well, it's just interesting that you, on the one hand, insist on the idea of how it is removed from the personality or how he removed himself, and at the
yeah.
same time, of course, you talk about the conflict that exists and these sort of existential issues that are being debated there.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Yeah. I mean, I was in, you know, I just did a lot of reading to prepare for it, and I was just interested. The range of writing about his work is so wide, from the most kind of Gene Fisher philosophical and kind of tragic and deep close perspective to really glib, bitchy, clever reviews in the Village Voice. I mean, it elicits the entire spectrum of responses, all which are interesting, bad or good, I thought.
Well, it was certainly something that you had to take a position on, or you have to take a position on when you're exposed to it and look at it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. We had some slides that you... that we wanted to perhaps have a look at. And I just wanted to maybe see... if you guys wanted to talk about some of those, can you see it on the screen?
I can see it here, no. Yeah. I just want to make sure it's there. I should talk about it?
Well, I think...
no, I can. No, I mean, that's the idea.
Just, yeah.
This was a... I was doing a series of very short films, and emphasizing film, not video, because... Video was pretty easy at that time at CalArts. I think we had 26 Sony Portapak cameras when we started. It's quite amazing. film, nobody could do film. You know, the whole idea of CalArts was that it, you know, that all the schools would interact. Nope. Film school, they got all the money pretty much, and they kept a pretty close guard of, you know, film school was the film school. But I finagled just friends and faculty and so on, to get a cameraman and an Aeroflex camera and sound equipment, lights and everything in our classroom for a few days. And I said, I want you all, you're invited to make short films. I didn't want to do long films because they're, most of the videos at that time were either 30 minutes or 1 hour, because that was the length of a reel of videotape. And nobody did any editing, they just did real time. So I said, let's do some really short things. So, you know, that you can watch or you cannot watch it, as I mentioned to you earlier, you know, kind of like Empire, which is really, really a long film, but, you know, you don't have to watch it end to end. You can just say, you know, a minute or 2 minutes. Anyway, so I said, yeah, anybody can do short films. They all were making them. And I think where, you know, this, you know, was, I think one of the places, obviously, the seed was planted for Jack to do some, you know, the short films. And in this film, what I'm doing, I just have two little containers of dry pigment, and I just put my finger into one, and the pigment comes out, and put my finger into the other one, and the pigment comes out, and that's it.
I think that.
And this one, you'll probably, Jack liked a lot. There are two little buttons you can wear, and kind of glossy, you know, film stars. And then the other side is a mirror. So I would just, you know, turn one and turn the other back and forth, and then it would catch the light, lighting set, and then it would bounce back into the film and make flares in the film.
Do you remember which year this was? I can't see.
Well, they were in the early 70s.
The early 70s as well. Yeah. It's striking that the resemblance to some of the films of Jack with this close-up and the, you know, use of color and the simplicity of the background.
And this is, this is probably my favorite because it's pretty much is what it is. It's called Time and Temperature. right? Nothing visually arresting about it at all. The film lasts as long as it takes the sand to go from the top to the bottom, and then you see the temperature raise in that period of time to within the duration of those 3 minute, probably a 3 minute.
Three hour. Minutes and 42 seconds. Yeah. Is that exactly the amount of time it takes?
I think Jack did a piece about similar to this. It's changing water to wine to water. You know, it's an old chemistry trick you can do.
Really?
No. You don't drink it. You don't try it when you run out of wine.
No. Don't try this at home. But I heard about someone else doing this. What do we have here?
Yeah, this was a piece here at the Jewish Museum.
Yeah, this was a piece that you showed here at the software exhibition.
Which was, I think, was the first. It beat MoMA, this first show in conceptual art. And all the conceptual artists were upstairs, and then all the people dealing with computer stuff is downstairs. And we artists would call it, it's mind over matter. I had just burned all my paintings and reduced them to ashes. This is what I proposed, that I wanted to bury the ashes in an urn inside a wall of the museum and have this plaque on the outside. And that's all you would see, you know, it would just be that. And one of your trustees said she would shut off all her funding if that happened. And so we did not have it. We had it inside a fake wall.
I see. I wish we still
had it. These are the compromises we have to make.
It would have been nice to still have that. We have a Solowit still here. So 53 was the year that you first painted, and 66 was when the...
I stopped painting.
66. That's what it says. I think there's some other images here of the actual act of when this happened.
Yeah, and this is the paintings being cremated. the guy that at night, it was actually in crematorium. What was cool, he had studied art. He was an art major.
And he was like, I'm with you here.
Yeah, so he really got into
it. It's a collaboration, and you didn't acknowledge his co-authorship in this piece. This is you.
I'm examining, and examining the ashes, like, holy shit, those are my paintings.
Oh my God, how many paintings is it?
I didn't count.
But
I know the yield. No, I got the yield. I know the yield. They have these kind of boxes about 12 inches by 8, let's say by 3. And it's the size of the ashes for one adult.
Wow.
And then they have smaller ones for babies and limbs.
Oh.
And my yield was 9.5 boxes, so I can tell you that.
Oh, well, that's many bodies.
This is a recent piece. I think this was coming in because of the shepherd, the German shepherd.
You like this because of Jack?
Yeah. I hadn't seen it before. This was the reason why you started printing rather than writing.
Yes. This is the way I wrote, you know, and I said, God, that is so butt ugly.
Can you read it?
And then so I said, I'm not going to write anymore, I'm just going to print. And then that was it. That's the last time I wrote.
But this was very much your attitude towards your student. Wasn't this based on an assignment that you gave students?
No, it was, I used to keep a notebook in my pocket, I was clumped together with all the other conceptual artists, and I thought I was interested in language, but I'd gone to college and university, and I thought language didn't have to be dry and academic; it could be language. And so I wrote a note to myself: I will not make any more boring art. And then I made a video where I just wrote it over and over again as punishment.
Yeah, of course, like a school punishment.
Yeah.
And can you read that?
I can't even read it.
What is painting? Do you sense how all the parts of a good picture?
I know. These are not things I wrote.
No, I wanted to actually have it read because, and then I thought it was a nice beginning.
Oh, it's not projected?
It is.
Okay.
Do you sense how all the parts of a good picture involve with each other, not just placed side by side? Art is a creation for the eye and can only be hinted at with words.
I don't know why you were sent that, other than that was an early one of the pieces I just did after I stopped painting. But these are all texts I got out of the giveaway art magazines and art stars, and these were bits of advice to people in the art magazines.
But
I said, I believe that.
The most well-known in that series is probably the one about how to make a work of art. What's the exact title of it? The painting, to be a successful painter.
Oh, yeah.
You talk about the animals.
That was a little thing. I bought a shirt, and it was a little thing I found in the shirt pocket. It's called quality materials. Good workmanship, good craftsmanship, all brought together to bring you a great shirt. And I just said, great painting.
So now we're going to move over.
Straight to the graveyard.
Straight to the graveyard.
I have a more kind of a somber take on the picture, I guess. It's like, I like a lot of complexity, I guess. And So anyway, this is a painting from the first chapter in the system I use, which is basically every time I do a show, it's a new chapter. So there's 25 to date. And this is chapter one, called The Sun. And it began in 2001. I think a year later, Jack came to New York to do a performance with the Boxers in 02. I was reading about that and I remembered because I couldn't go, but I remember Warren Nesklahowski was going, and it was just a big deal. And so it's just history I think about, because I remember also when he committed suicide was just the time that we went to war with Iraq, and he had this prediction about images and war, that we'd be able to see the war close up. And I thought it was interesting that he ended it right at that moment, in a way, visually, when it actually that did come true, like in a way, his paintings, what he was painting, did actually happen. But this is the Jewish graveyard in Łódź, Poland, where I visited for one day when I was doing a show in another part of Poland. And my family, or my father's family, had been come from there. So that was just one image.
Thanks for all mm-hmm. the fathers.
And that was a book, because just the book and language question. Book one, Fear. And so that one's a dark. I was trying to find the dark imagery that I could find, like, that would relate to a kind of, fear. Book one, Fear. Pretty much, I think that he could start his book out with that same heading.
Mm.
And then this op, the use of op, I guess in a way is the closest that I would get to a kind of glam Hollywood quick read. But I think I do it for different reasons than he, of course, but...
Yeah, there's a similarity to some of his paintings in terms of the opticality of this particular piece. No?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's just a lineup. Because my whole problem was to get out of the photograph. Like, I wanted to figure out a way to be an abstract painter again. And I realized... actually, the big problem was the photograph and the image and, one-point perspective. Like, it was just more and more overtaking us in every aspect of our life, and it was just impossible or silly to ignore it. So my idea was, how could I make you slide out of the picture onto the picture plane, back onto the picture plane, back into the installation, back to the other painting beside it? So it's a way, like, how... My interest is how to take the accent off the single painting. And that was this installation at the Whitney Biennial. So I just, people kind of know that one most, because it...
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah. You were also part of Orchard Street.
Orchard Gallery was a gallery I ran with 12 other artists for 3 years in... beginning in 2005, ending in 2008, and I don't think that, well, yeah.
No, please, what?
I don't know how that relates. Well,
I was just thinking that
Jack so ran from people, ran from...
I don't think he would ever organize a space or a gallery, but I think that perhaps his work... I don't know, Orchard perhaps as a sort of continuation of places that would have come up in the 70s, like Artist Space or...
Yeah, that's true.
And a type of space that didn't exist anymore, that was also very closely connected to the art that the artists were making themselves and the way that they,
Right. It was sort of trying to say, you don't have to just... be in the system. You do have, autonomy. You do have agency, and in stark contradiction to, I think, Jack's feeling about the art world as a kind of monolithic system that was impenetrable, and that, you play the game kind of thing. So this, we're just trying not to play the game, I think, or make... are a few of our own rules, not all.
You also have worked as a curator in the past.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
How much do you think that has sort of influenced your own work?
A lot.
And in which way?
Because I'm more interested in how paintings group together than in the individual painting. But that is something I do feel an affinity with his work, because I think his work, the most interesting way to think of it is overall rather than each individual piece. And that's how I like to think of my work too, is like a thing that you're working the whole, from a far distance in a way, away from the moment or the individual piece, so.
Yeah. The exhibition that we have downstairs that was organized or curated by Philip Kaiser, who at that point was a curator at the Museum of Contemporary Art in Los Angeles, and the show was canceled there, and they brought it over to the Orange County Museum where it was first shown, and then it came here. And I saw the installation in Los Angeles, and the first thing that I saw, it was really how incredibly consistent I felt the work was from the very beginning to the very end. I don't recall really having that experience with many other artists. I remember once seeing an early show of Douglas Gordon where I had a similar feeling, but it doesn't happen a lot. So I felt like...
Well, you know, one thing that I might address was Jack's feeling for perfection, which was, you know, you've seen all the work that it's flawless, and you know, how he tried to figure out how to get a flat painted surface and... You know, looking at Ed Reinhardt and Barnett Newman's, and no, it's got to be flat. but the whole aesthetic at the time when Jack was out there, and he was very much a part of it, was what we called finish fetish, and just incredible attention to how something was crafted, and any artist of that same generation in New York would just look clunky. I mean, it's just not well made at all. But you know, they held that such high regard. And Jack, you know, the Orange County show here, you know, everything is perfect. And Jack, his whole idea is, yeah, well, you don't have to do it yourself. People can make it perfect for you. And one of the things he loved when he was doing the short films, that he and Steven Spielberg were equal, that Jack could get access to the same people that Steven Spielberg did, but he could only do it by the hour and Spielberg forever. But that was the only difference.
Where do you think his... it's often said that he was employing... that he was very interested in the latest technologies, I don't know. I'm always never really sure how true that really is. That he had this interest in new technologies, and that he was trying to employ those new technologies in his work.
It's kind of dicey.
Yeah.
I think that's referring maybe to the last paintings that had to do with a kind of scientific opticality.
Yeah.
No, I think with Jack, the any means to get to an end, he would do it. But if that meant embracing technology, fine. He didn't have to understand it, just so he could get it done.
But I did read that he was obsessive about doing the gesso himself, that even though he didn't do the actual airbrushing.
Yeah, but that's about getting the perfect surface.
I know, but I am also obsessive about gesso. So I thought, and less obsessed about the silkscreen. So I thought that was interesting, actually. And then I did think about the difference between, I was thinking, because I just bought equipment to do the airbrush or whatever, and I was thinking, well, what is the difference between, why didn't you just use silkscreen? I mean, you can do silkscreen perfectly. Why was it, I mean, obviously there's cars and everything, but with a silk screen, it's like a wave of liquid, and with a airbrush, it's really like a gun. I mean, it feels aggressive.
Well, there would be a lot of reasons for that. Rauschenberg and Warhol to begin with.
That you wouldn't use silk screen.
No, they would.
Oh no, I know they did, but why didn't he use silk screen?
Because they did.
That's okay. No.
Yeah. And it was a possibility.
So you think
that
he wanted to differentiate himself that way?
Pretty much.
I mean, I think it also does require a lot more skill to do an airbrush.
Well, Jack didn't do it.
No, I know. Well, he couldn't because it is a
well,
kind of arcane skill.
Well, not that he couldn't do it. He could find people that did it better.
Yeah. Right. It's kind of like a skill that kind of, it's very macho, kind of cars and sports.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, comes out of LA car culture.
Right.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I just think that's interesting that he would choose that.
So this is going on here. I just
One before.
Oh, this is the one that I wanted to come to.
This image is I collect this printmaker named John Martin, and it occurred to me that his imagery was similar in many ways to Jack's work, in this kind of apocalyptic, the end, the big, you know, devastating, in the sky, the storm, the light. It reminded me of him, and Dan Graham always, he loves him too, we both love him, and he says, he thinks that he was, that John Martin's work was a kind of from the shell shock of the Industrial Revolution, and it was the first sci-fi, in a way, the beginning of sci-fi. This is an image from I used just the photo anonymous photographs from the SF MoMA's photography collection, and it was this big old rattlesnake I liked. But it really is, of course, more complicated, but I won't go into it.
Mm-hmm. So this is we have the remake or replica downstairs. I just wanted to show another work that only exists as an image here of the very sort of early work. But even in his work and
me too.
The forms, the lines, the repetition, the fragility of all of it. You know, nothing is held together by screws or glue.
But it's also, in a very strange way, just sort of copying minimalism, what he would see in a magazine, from a remove, a kind of. It's kind of a joke, but it's kind of not. It's kind of like, oh, this is what the art world is. I'm going to do it.
I don't think it's a joke. I think it's very serious.
Very serious.
Yeah. But
and I think that's probably also why John advised him not to continue to do this work.
But don't you think it was a little bit, not a joke, but it was a criticism in a sense?
No, absolutely reverence.
Good. Well, let me just see where we are. Perhaps you should talk or comments or... So you're all welcome to join the conversation. We have a microphone here. Maybe that helps.
Ms. Quaytman, you talked about the vanilla drama. Mm-hmm. Of Goldstein's work and your interest in that. And I am really interested in your work. And I wanted to hear about where in it you find melodrama. Because it sounded like you identified with that melodrama and were participating in it.
In Jack's work? Where do I find it?
Well, no, in your own work.
Oh, in my own work.
And which seems to be so involved in the sort of Finnish fetish, some of that,
mm-hmm.
and very intellectual sorts of appropriations of other work and interest in sequential works and all mm-hmm. of that. So mm-hmm. I'd just like to know where the melodrama in Europe is, which I appreciate.
I guess it wouldn't be so really direct, but I'm very influenced by Charlotte Bronte, for example, and 19th century literature and novels, and I love, like I thought, How could you make a show be a cliffhanger? Like, how could you do that? I haven't figured out a way. But I would love it if I could. But yeah, I love stories. I love illustrations. And I guess illustrations are very often illustrate melodramas.
Yeah, there's a question in the back.
I really like the name of tonight's discussion, How is Jack Goldstein? And I think a lot about how Jack Goldstein made art, you know, these roles that he was, you know, a director, but also a producer, an administrator, a choreographer, and a painter. And to locate it as coming after, you know, simply, you know, these LA precedents you mentioned, John, Billy Albex, and Larry Bell, there's something else. There's something about how he was an active and inactive user and producer. I think there's something very perverse about his role, how he made art. A really radical rejection, not just of the studio genre, but what an author was. And that, to me, is radical invention. And I was hoping you could all talk about your own voices or activities and processes as authors versus managers versus administrators, and how that played out in his work.
Well, I think one thing I sort of stressed to everybody that it didn't matter who did the work. I mean, if you want to do it, fine. If you can get somebody else to do it, fine. The only problem was you get somebody else doing the work, you had to pay them. I remember Bill Wegman, used to say you can always, you know, tell a video done in the 70s because it's the camera's on the artist. And when the tape begins, the artist gets up and turns on the camera, and when the tape's over, he gets up and turns off the camera. If Bill had money to pay for people, he would do that. But you know, he didn't. Nobody had any money, so you sort of reduced to doing the work yourself. But the idea of finish was so embedded in LA culture, not just through art, but it got picked up by artists just by the car culture because of the constant climate, cars didn't deteriorate. And so you could have a car with maybe 100 coats of paint on it, you know, and beautifully rubbed down between each coat. You like to rub down gesso, right?
Right.
I mean, that's where that comes from. And pinstriping cars and airbrushing cars and so on. And then artists start, the surf culture picked up on it next and doing surf arts. And then, you know, artists living in Venice by the beach and surfing, you know, then they got into their work. This kind of incredible attention to detail and where almost that became the, you know, the reason to be, to do work.
Mm-hmm. You wanted to respond to that?
I would just say about the whole self kind of thing, and whether it's him or not. In my view, it's absolutely impossible to get away from the self, no matter what you do, no matter how many people make your work. It's always radically an author, but I do think Jack Goldstein does get scarily away from that, almost. To me, that
but
is very extreme.
But how do you deal with the paradox of them on incredible need for attention?
Well, I didn't know him. I just know the work.
Well, that was one of the reasons for doing the work.
Mm. Attention, yeah. But I think he wanted to be like Maxwell says, just a producer. Like, he wanted to be a successful businessman, almost.
So you don't have to do the work. I mean, I think Alan Caprow had that idea really back. You know, you're like a movie. You just run things.
Right.
Yeah. It doesn't mean it's not art.
No, I'm not saying that at all.
Yeah.
Well, I have been thinking about the idea of authorship, particularly in relationship to exhibition making. And one text that I've always come back to was an article that François Truffaut wrote for Cahiers de Cinéma, which was called A Certain Tendency in French Cinema. And there he refers back to Michel Foucault, who wrote a response to Ronald Barthes, The Death of the Author. And I think Foucault's article was titled What is an Author? And that article, essay, he kind of, I feel like, describes very much this sort of idea of the author, the way that I think we see it in someone like the arts from the picture generation, where it's not really about the novel creation anymore. It is about filtering through all the offers that the world gives you, the chaos that exists, and bringing an order into that chaos, because you come up with a certain index that right. does that. So Jack invented his very own index there and used the existing materials that were around him.
Yeah, but it's also a cultural shift. You know, his anti-abstract expressionism was all about bearing the chest and the struggle of the artist and blah, 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 et cetera. And you know, then we got minimalism. Like Don Judd didn't want to have his presence in his work, for sure. I mean, it was all laid out for Jack.
Well, we were talking about this before when we were saying there's no humor in his work, and I was, I'm actually laughing when I go into the gallery and I hear these sounds of a steamship, or you know, what does that do there? How does it come there? And at the same time, as you were like saying, it's not supposed to be funny. It's just very direct.
We can't dictate how work's received, as you know.
Well, it makes sense in the relationship to what you were saying in the response to abstract expressionism or minimal art. And
well, I mean, it's pretty clear with Jack, you know, that trying to avoid any trace of a brushstroke in his painting.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yes, please. There's two questions in the front. The gentleman in the tank top.
For a gentleman, I'm just curious why you suggested to Jack that he destroy that sculpture.
I mean, the sound's not so good being with one.
Why did you suggest that he would destroy his work?
Did you
destroy his
sculpture? I mean, I don't know if this is even true. It's just maybe.
What's the question?
That somewhere, didn't you say that you suggested he get destroy or stop making the early sculpture? Did you
no,
suggest
never,
that?
No, never did.
Oh.
I think he just assumed that. I guess I have a kind of readable face.
Good.
Two questions. One, I can't quite work out with Goldstein's work, what's kind of individual and unique about it, or is he more part of the group that came out of CalArts? That's one thing from all the work I've seen. One question is, what would both of you, or all three of you, say stands out as completely amazing about what Goldstein did? The second thing, which we haven't talked about, which always happens, is generations who buy the art, and I think Goldstein was hoping independent that maybe somebody would buy his art. And that shifted over the years, especially after 2000 or the late 90s. And talk about what happened to the shift in terms of Goldstein's work and the public that was buying art. So two questions. What's kind of stood out as individual in him, and what happened when the market shifted later on in the 90s?
The first question was, why does he stand out?
Why does Jack stand out?
Yeah.
I think he wouldn't stand out so much if he hadn't committed suicide. Pretty much. Okay, and
like that is the elephant in the room, kind of. I mean, I actually got kind of angry about it myself, that thing, because I feel like as a visual artist, he must have known that hanging yourself, it's so visual. Like, it's almost like putting some kind of tattoo on all your work. Like, everybody will see that first, somehow. It's so visual, in a way. But it is a kind of, you know, it's there. It's there.
I mean, perhaps slightly difficult to say that the significance of Jack Goldstein lies in the fact that he committed suicide.
Say it again.
No, not as a significant, but I'm angry that he did.
No, yeah. But what John was saying, why does he stand out, or why is his work significant in saying that this is completely...
Well, you run the movie backwards. I mean, we can't do this, of course, but blot out his suicide. He kind of gets in the camp, let's say, of Bastianader, who mysteriously disappeared, and a far more interesting artist than Jack, in my mind. But would Bastianader have as much, we would have as much interest in him either? I mean, I talk about this artist myth out there that we buy into, including myself. It's just more fun. And I don't know if I told you this one, but she came a little bit later than Jack at CalArts, Mick Cranston. I had interviewed him several times. And she said, Jack seriously thought that book, Jack Goldstein and the CalArts Mafia, could be a movie, and he thought it's going to be a hit. And he was totally, no joke, it's going to be a hit. But he said, the only problem, it doesn't have an ending.
Yeah, but he always suggests the end from the very beginning.
Yeah.
I mean, that is interesting.
The end is constantly present.
The end is always there. It's like the astronaut cut off from the ship. It's the burial. It's the nature of the aphorisms. I mean, to me, what is interesting about him is not him at all. In fact, I'm so glad I didn't know him, frankly. It's the work and what that work says. And it is so dark.
How do you know who Jack was? Nobody knew who he was.
No, I don't. That's what I'm saying. I'm not interested in that. I'm interested in what the work is saying. And that work is not very American, and there's no cheer. It is doom, and it is kind of apocalyptic dystopia. And that is interesting. I mean,
that you mentioned. That's the flip side of the cheerfulness that you normally associate with it. But very Los Angeles in many ways, in that it has these dark undertones.
It is interesting, this whole just leaving the art world and disappearing.
Would you be saying that had he not committed suicide? You would still be saying this.
Well, I say it about Agnes Martin. Yeah, she also disappeared. I mean, people, they leave on purpose.
Would you say that prior to her disappearance or prior to Jack, would you still be saying that it's very dark?
Yeah, I definitely think I would.
All right.
Yeah. Totally. Definitely.
I don't know if I could.
The work is dark? Yeah.
Yeah, maybe... Do we have time for more questions?
I would say that Jack's work really stood out tremendously at the time that he was doing it in the 70s, because he managed to marshal very large amounts of money to get these films made that were just much, just a different level of accomplishment from anything that anybody else was doing. Erica Beckman was making great films, but they were not on the same level. Perfectionism was definitely Jack's characteristic, and he was very much about surface. He always wore these blue-tinted sunglasses, and he was very much very superficial, and actually, I think he really wasn't very much of a sane person. He wasn't a very complete person. He was totally about making art. And every time he made a new piece of art, he would come up to you and go, "It's great, isn't it? It's fantastic. The best thing I've ever done, right? Isn't it incredible? It's the greatest work of art anybody's ever done. Don't you think so? I think it's the greatest, my best work, right? My best work, right?" He always did that. Every time he did anything new.
Yeah.
And also, one time he told me, and I've never heard anybody else say this, but he told me that he met Foucault, and Foucault was planning to write about his paintings.
Wow. Wow.
Is there a question there? It's a comment. Okay.
It's a comment. It's a question. Good. Is there any more questions? You had some aphorisms written down.
Oh, I mean, in a way, my favorite, I just really like the aphorisms and the way he printed those works. And I love also his works that he did on records and the sound work. I just love the MGM film. I just think that's such a beautiful, I mean, I do think that's a very important piece of work. But I kind of took some of his aphorisms and switched them as a reflection on him. This is one, actually, this is one beautiful Kafka aphorism. It goes, "The true way is along a rope that is not spanned high in the air, but only just above the ground. It seems intended more to cause stumbling than to have walked upon." I like that. And he said, one of his aphorisms, I think, was simply, "There are trees falling in the forest." So I wrote, "I heard a tree fell in the forest, but I didn't actually see it. He died, so I can't tell him tomorrow did come, but it won't come again. He was beautiful from a great enclosed distance. He hung his rope on the horizon, looking lost, hearing found." Just things, simple things like that. And actually, I realized aphorisms are the greatest way to think about painting. That was a revelation. They really work for painting.
Well, good. Then I would like to thank Rebecca and John very, very much for this evening. Thanks to all of you for coming, and please come back on September 22nd for the final public program.